to delete, close this WhatsApp so I don't get disturbed. Meeting is now streaming live on YouTube. Okay, but we don't have a meeting now, do we? Ratan, you there?
Yep, I'm here.
Ulvax is trying to get in.
Okay, I'm bringing you. So we have 5 minutes from starting, right?
Right. Hi, Ulvax.
Hi.
We're going to be in gallery view.
I'm in, Ratan. Ratan, you have to make me co-host.
Yeah, he needs to make you co-host.
Oh, yes, the uncle, either one of them.
No, he's the host now. I can't make you a co-host. I think I can. Wait one sec. No, I think he can only make you a co-host.
All right. Got it. Thanks. Yezdi uncle, do you have your YouTube live on as well?
Yeah, I'm going to now mute my YouTube.
Yeah.
Around 4 to 7, I'm giving and asking for X. 88. understand no longer. But this one is more convenient, we will deliver it. Is quality better? I presume we are all sourcing from the same place.
They have restaurants. That's not the issue. They should
have let us. He should have told us. I said, a price of 200 is 340. Okay, here we go.
Yes, the uncle, we're good to go.
We start now. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the second episode of Koffee with Yezdi. We have got an evening where we take our ladies and men's teams in the Parsi club through different generations, a walk down memory lane. This evening is divided into three segments. We'll have the ladies up first, then we'll have a little break, and I have invited back, and he's very graciously accepted to come back on the show. We will have Dr. Daraya Sankarsari at around 7, and then we will have the men's. In between, we will, of course, have musical bandbox. And in musical bandbox this evening, we are introducing our three divas plus one. The three divas are the ones I call three divas in our Drama Kids program, and they're going to perform songs for you. And the plus one is a surprise package you probably have never heard of before. So let's get started, and I'll ask Ratan to let the ladies in, and we start with the ladies' session first.
And they're joining right now.
Hi guys.
Hey. Hi. Hi. Hi.
Good morning.
Hi.
Hi.
Good morning. Hi Kamal. Good morning.
Hi. Good morning.
Close your mouth.
Looking very sharp for this early in the morning.
She's put on all her makeup also.
No makeup.
No. No makeup. No makeup. Only no,
Kamal. Okay.
She's probably the only one who's actually having coffee now.
Yezdi.
Yeah.
Will you unmute us, or do we need to do it?
You're already unmuted. Everyone's unmuted.
Everyone
no, I mean mute. I meant mute.
Oh, no. Let everyone come in. I'll do
everything.
Hi. I can't hear you very well.
Can you hear me now? Is this better?
Come here.
Mom's coming on Zoom.
Can you all hear me?
Yes. Kamal, you are clear.
Can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Okay, Pilu and Kamala and Nawazaban, Prochi, are we waiting for anyone else, or can we get
that's everyone, if I'm not wrong. Yes, yeah, there's nobody else waiting.
Okay, can you mute everyone except me?
Yeah, I'll do that.
Okay, so you will now be here. We will unmute people.
Yep, okay.
Okay. Right, ladies, thank you very much for coming to the show and all the hard work you guys have done, including sending me about 70 WhatsApp messages since 8 o'clock this morning. I have never studied that hard for my CA exam that I've had to study for today's session, so I hope I pass. Anyway, ladies, before we get started, and for the audience generally, our walk down memory lane is not about individuals and individual brilliance. Of course, individuals come into teams, but the focus is on the Parsi Club teams of the last 60 years who did whatever they did on the hockey and other areas of our sports. So before I get started and the questions, I want to make a couple of points on protocol. Hand up if you want to speak. Secondly, I will apologize once at the beginning of the show and not after that. I may, in the interest of time and keeping things to moving along smoothly, have to mute you at a particular point in time and move on to the next question. Please forgive me for doing that. Right, guys. Right, ladies. So I want to tell the viewers, you know, when I was researching this, I was totally bowled over and shocked, actually. And many people may not know this. In 1931, until 1931, ladies were not admitted to the Parsi Club, and a proposal put forward on that in that year was not approved. when the proposal was reintroduced in 1932, it passed with 10 votes to 7. Okay, 10 votes to 7. And thank God, those were times that, you know, and we don't have discrimination now. But you know what? It took us 86 years before we got our first lady president in 2018. 86 years. Shouldn't happen again, huh? Ladies, the reason why you all are first on the show is not because it's ladies first. The reason why you are on the show first is because compared to the men, you all have won more titles as teams, and you all have represented the state many more times than the men has done. So I thought it merited that you come on this stage first. So the session is split into really two segments, hockey and basketball. We'll be starting with hockey. And in basketball, we have four segments. We've got the Parsi Club teams of yesteryears. Then we've got another segment where we talk about inter-office sports, the Butlerian tournament, the Zambian girls who came and visited us, the league title that we won, and the office bearers and how we've served in different state associations and continue to this day. And in the third segment, we will have a chat with all our players, all our ladies who played for Bengal at some point in their careers. And we'll have a remembrance of two people we dearly miss. And then we will end with anecdotes. So we're already a little late. So we're going to start right away. And we're going to start with hockey. What I want to start off with is people should know that it was only in 1947, 15 years after ladies were admitted to the club, that the ladies hockey section was started. There's very little information between 1947 and 1966. And in 1966, after two decades that hockey was revived, the ladies promptly won the B division of the league. And then by 1969, our ladies were playing hockey for Bengal. So I'm going to now ask Beroz to take us through her recall of hockey in those years. And I need to unmute you. Right. Okay, Beroz, you're on.
Do I just start off with talking about the hockey?
Okay. Yeah.
We, the hockey in the ladies section, we began with Jalu Medora coaching us along with Behram Jilla and Badur Postwala. Almost all of us in the team were picked up by Badur at 6 a.m. for practice at 6 a.m. from our homes nearly every single morning. And he would also drop us back after practice was over. If we happened to reach the finals in any tournament, Badur would promise us breakfast at Flurries if we won. But he did treat us at Flurries even if we lost. Probably we were the first ladies hockey team in the club.
Thank you, Beroz. I have a bone now to pick with Badur Postwala, because whether we won or lost, we never got taken to Flurries.
But he did that because he promised us, and he would also help Jalu to coach us along with Behram.
So what were the conditions of hockey in those days? And tell us why hockey has ceased to exist as a sport in the club.
Actually, the hockey tournament ceased to exist because there was some problem with some girls, some team, with the association. They filed some case. I think Rhoda can say more on that, since she was in the committee.
Okay. Well, that's understood. You know, in 1966, we won the B division of the league. Were any of you in the team at that time?
Yes, I was there.
You were?
I think Kamal, Shireen, Zareen, Rhoda, all of us were there.
So, amongst the ladies, anybody wants to say anything? There we are. We've got a picture of that ladies' team in 1966. Yeah. And I recognize some of them. Who was the goalkeeper? Was that Hitoxi Choksi?
Yes, correct.
Okay, I got that. I got that. Okay, lovely. Right, before we move on to basketball, floor is open. Does anybody else wish to say anything on hockey? Yes, Rhoda.
Yeah, I.
Okay, Beroz, go. Beroz is going or shall I go?
Beroz can go first, you can follow.
I'd like to say that when we would have morning practice, Nawaz would refuse to get up. So many a times, Rhoda literally sat on Nawaz and wore her shoes and her socks. And even then, she did not get up. And if anybody asked Rhoda, where is Nawaz? She literally blew a fuse.
Well. Yes, Rhoda, you have anything to add to that story?
Yeah, I would like to add. Yeah, I did. I could blow a fuse in those days quite fast. Can I recount one match we played against Rangers? Against Rangers when we, in the A Division Hockey League, which we won the championships that year. Where the match was going ding-dong. Nobody was scoring till the final whistle. And it was a draw. So both the referees and Rangers club agreed on a penalty shootout, which was agreed, and we won on that. And we were so jubilant. But next day, the Rangers put in a protest, and that they said we should have played extra time and then had the penalty shootout, which was not fair. And there were lots of meetings and lots of fighting over that match. But eventually, it was awarded to us, and we were the champions of that year.
That's
good.
What
I wanted to add.
Yes, Pilu?
There's only one thing I remember about the hockey. I was a very average player. And to my utter surprise, I scored the very first goal in the very first match that we played in hockey. There was no great skill involved. Somebody gave me a good pass and I was positioned very strategically near the goalpost. So I just pushed the ball into the goal.
Well, this is our sign for applause. So you can applaud whenever you wish to applaud. Not like this. Like yeah. Okay, guys.
Well done, Pilu.
Let us switch now from hockey to basketball. Basketball has been the sport for ladies in the club. And your achievements are so numerous that when I tried to collate all of them, I eventually gave up and I said, I'll just leave it to you all to talk about it. But with one snippet of background information, there is no recorded date of when basketball first started in the club. But in 1945, the ladies went to the first division of the league. And by 1967, we had teams in the A, B, and C division. So, floor is open. Talk us about the Parsi Club teams in the 60s and the 70s and how you all, coped with tournament conditions, how you passed the torch on to the next generation. Yes, Cole, go ahead.
Yeah. I'm just speaking on behalf of my mom of your basketball from 1945 onwards.
Oh, lovely.
Yeah. So she's, I've written it down, what she told me. My memories of basketball at the club are vivid, though the details may be a little hazy. The game was played very differently in those days. You could not cross the half line. The defender stayed in their half and the forward stayed in the offensive half. I was a defender, that's my mom, Dina Adesha, and our job was to stop the opponent's forwards from scoring, while at the same time getting the ball to our forwards to score. I was a part of the first Parsi team to be promoted from B division to A division. The others on the team, as far as I can remember, were Shelley Billimoria, used to be Palamkot, Katie Moddy, also used to be Palamkot, Dolly Dastur, who was a terrific shot and would stand under the basket, Homai Dastur, Billimoria, Dina Langrana, Billimoria, Gul Bharucha, Katie Bharucha, and myself, Dina Adesha, Divitri. There is a picture of this team in one of the old Parsi club souvenirs, but I didn't have time to get it out. Khurshid asked me if I played after marriage, and I know I did. And I remember Shelley playing too. Our opponents were mainly Anglo-Indian teams, such as the Wanderers, West Club, which had the fantastic Beak Sisters, Grail Club and Calcutta Rangers Club. And we played on the grass courts opposite the ICI buildings. Most of us were referees. And I remember that Minnie Reiter and I were selected to referee the finals of a tournament at the Red Road Ground, which was a very big deal with the governor, etc., in attendance. I have many happy memories of basketball, and I played for many years amongst other sports in the club.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That was quite amazing that we have somebody from 1945 able to recall this almost more than 90 years down the road. It will be great. Thank you, Dinanti. Thank you very much. So moving on to basketball teams in the late 60s and 70s, all of you were a part of it. So take it away, ladies, and tell us whatever you wish to tell us before we move on to the next segment. Yes, Nawaz.
Yeah, I started playing Parsi Club basketball in the C division, maybe I think in 65, 66, the very first time. And I recall a match when we played Rangers. We were one goal down, 18-20. I went on and shot one goal. We became 20 all, and then one more I shot. So we won by 2 points. And that's how I moved on to the B division. And much later, I went on to play for the A team also for the Parsi Club.
So who were your main competitors as teams of basketball in those days? Anybody? Yes, Mayor.
I think as far as competitors were concerned, it was more or less constant right through, except for sometimes maybe, say, Rakhi Sangha were there, then 1 or 2 years they didn't play. Otherwise, it was always the Loretto were always there. Rangers were always there. Safis were always there. I don't know, in Nawaz and Rhoda's time, maybe you can ask, you can add maybe a Grail Club to that list. But I think it was pretty much, that was pretty much constant from the late 60s to into the 70s, that group of teams. Then later on, Eastern Railway, much later, all these other teams came in. But otherwise, it was always a Loretto, Safis, Rangers, us, and maybe 1 or 2 Bengali teams. Rakhi Sangha for sure were there quite a few years. But outside of that, I can't remember, unless Rhoda will tell you.
Yes, Rhoda.
I thought Good Counsel was also there that time with the Bengali team.
Yeah.
And there was Wanderers and all. I don't know if y'all remember. We
were much earlier. Much earlier.
Much earlier, yeah. Much earlier, I'm talking about.
Much earlier, yeah.
And mostly it was Anglo-Indian girls who dominated the basketball scene those years.
Yeah.
Let me ask a question.
Kamal wants to say something.
Sorry, yes, Kamal.
Hi, yeah. I want to add to what Nawaz said. We were in the C team and our coach was Rusi Surti. And under his guidance, I think we won the C team. Then we won the B team. And if I'm not mistaken, we also went into the A team after winning the B team. And Rusi was a great coach.
Well, that's so great to hear. Aban, if I'm going to turn to you and ask you, Anni had a big role in creating a mini basketball team for girls. Could you share some of that with us?
Yeah, sure. Actually, my mom was a member of the CPC basketball team in the early 60s. Okay, but I think her major contribution...
Sorry, Aban, you need to speak up a bit. Speak up a bit.
Okay. Right. Can you hear a little better now?
Yeah, this is better. Just come closer to the computer and hold up your speakerphone.
Yeah. Okay. So my mom was a member of this Parsi Club team, which played in the early 60s. But by and large, her major contribution was as a coach to all of the youngsters in the late 60s and early 70s. In fact, she it was not one of those flash in the pan things. It's something that continued for a great many years, where every Sunday afternoon at 3 o'clock, ranging from around 5 to 6 year old girls to about 12, 13 year olds, we would be, yes, that's a lovely picture of all of us, or rather just a few of us, because on an average, there would be at least about 10 to 15 of us there. And mom managed to make it a good blend of hard work, discipline, as well as fun. So in a few years, as you can see, all us youngsters are wearing CPC colors. We are very much part of the Parsi Club team. And unfortunately, what happened then was that we beat Loretto House. We beat the Loretto team. And the next thing we knew was most of our parents were called to the principal's office. That how is it that Loretto girls are playing and beating our own school team? And we were kind of given the option that either you play for us or you find another school. But I think it's these early years where we had a chance to pick up the fundamentals, which helped many of us. I mean, at least 4 or 5 of us play in the West Bengal state team, both at junior and at senior level. So those... I think my mom's contribution there was pretty tremendous. Thanks.
Sure was, because one of the points to make here is that there have been people in our history and sports who have done something for the sport to make sure that it goes forward in the next generation. Not a coincidence, but the fact that your dad, Jalu, started hockey team in 67, of which I was one of the first guys. I wasn't good enough to play in the senior team. I'll be walking around with a hockey stick until one day there were 15 of us. He put us all together and said, okay, we are now playing third division. We didn't even know how to play, actually.
I think both mom and dad were passionate about sports, and they made sure that they did something which was not just for themselves, but for the club, which was their life. Yes.
Thank you, Aman. And thank Anneep. Thank Anneep for me.
Absolutely.
Yes, Rhoda.
I can add to that. Anni and Jalu had accompanied us on our Butlerian trip to New Delhi. If it wasn't for them, I don't think we would have made that trip, which was really good. And we had to have good practice sessions with Roington, running around the tennis, the club, on the road, right around the club perimeter, and to build up our stamina. And Anni and Jalu were excellent with us, and we just we were very thankful that they could come with us on that trip with us. And I think Pilu and Kamal have to say something on that Butlerian trip.
Can I take a little bit of a time out and go into our first musical bandbox break, and when we come back, you can pick it up from the Butlerian tourney and the Zambian team and anything else that you want to talk about, winning the league title, and then we'll move on from there. So, Ratan, are we ready with Bandbox 1? Viewers, the three divas. The first one is Anisa, and she's going to sing Mamma Mia.
Cheated by you since I don't know when, so I made up my mind it must come to an end. Look at me now, will I ever learn? I don't know how, but I suddenly lose control. There's a fire within my soul. Just one look and I can hear a bell ring. One more look and I forget everything. Whoa, 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 Mamma Mia, here I go again. My, how can I resist ya? Mamma Mia, does it show again? My, just how much I missed ya. Yes, I've been broken hearted, blue since the day we parted. Why did I ever let you go? Mamma Mia, now I really know. My an honor that you go.
From the break, I've just been following the chat on YouTube, and everybody's thanking Anni and Dina Aunty for their recollections. So thank you, ladies. And now let's move on to the second segment of second and third segments of the basketball part of our session. Anybody wants to talk about the inter-office leagues that you all used to play in? Yes, Kamal. Yes, Kamal.
I started playing for Union Carbide. I started McMillan Maker, and when I was playing for McMillan Maker, we were playing against ICI, and they were the top team, but we were very good too. And I remember at some point, Jennifer Bays came from behind, and I had the ball, and she pulled my right hand and dislocated my shoulder on the spot. And the irony is, her husband Wes was studying to be a medical doctor, and he's the one who set my hand. So I remember that, but it gave me trouble for many, many years. But I also want to acknowledge all that lime pani limbu juice that Amalis would make for all of us. And I think that was something that everybody looked forward to after the games were over at the Parsi Club. And I think we should remember the Malis, because this, God knows how many limbus they had to squeeze to make that big jug of limbu pani.
Thank you, Kamal. You actually just jogged my memory about a limbu pani story, which I will leave for later so that we can get along with this. But I'll recall that at the right time. Ladies, inter-office basketball and basketball in general, in those years in the 60s and 70s, what were the conditions like? What were the quality of the ball? As far as I remember, it used to be a heavy leather ball, right? So how did you handle it when it was raining? Yes, Beros.
It was horrible. Once the ball got wet, it was very heavy and it did not bounce. So at least now we have a better, like a rubber synthetic ball, which is easier to grip and much lighter. But those days it would be terrible when it would be playing, when it would rain.
So I don't know who that is, which team and which year that is, but it's got Rohinton Panthaki in there, and I can see Kamal on the left with a number 6, Anni on the right with a number 10. And Pilu, is that you with a cast on your leg?
Yes.
Unmute Pilu, please. Can't hear you. Yeah. On your leg?
I was no better in basketball than I was in hockey. Absolutely an average player. But what I lacked in ability, I made up in enthusiasm. So I remember the Delhi trip very clearly. It was in 1969, and I had been away to the US on an exchange, student exchange program for more than a year. So I was very rusty. I hadn't played in more than a year. Because at that time, the girls in US were still not playing basketball. They were relegated to the sidelines as cheerleaders or as part of the spirit team. Anyhow, I had not had a chance to play for a very long time and was very rusty. But I was so excited at the prospect of playing again that on the very first day, at the very first practice session in Delhi, on my very first dash across the court, I fell down and fractured my ankle. Not only did I not get to play in any of the games, poor Rohinton Panthaki, who was our coach, had to physically carry me about all over the place. That was a bad memory.
That's hilarious. Were there any major rule changes that happened between the 60s, 70s, and when you all were playing in the late 70s or early 80s? Any major rule changes? Yes, Rhoda.
The three-pointer came into that time. If we scored outside the area, the three-zone area, we were rewarded 3 points, which was not that in the first time. It was not there. It came on later. And what other things was there? This is the one that was definitely there. And something. Beros, anything else you remember?
Yeah, we played two halves of 20 minutes each, then came about four quarters with 10 minutes each.
and then the five team fouls. If there were five team fouls in any quarter, we got two free throws on the sixth foul, which was not there earlier.
Yes, Aban. Yes, Aban.
Can't hear.
We used to have...
Just hold it up to your in front of you so that you can hear.
Come quick. Okay, so we used to have wooden boards.
Yeah.
Not the fiberglass that we have right now. We had wooden boards. So the whole bounce of the ball against the board was very different.
Oh, that's a very important thing, actually. Prochi had a hand up before you. I'll come to you, Mayor. Yes, Proch?
Earlier, we used to have a tie ball where two players would jump up and tap the ball. Now, we only have a jump off at the beginning of the game. Otherwise, the ball is thrown in from the sideline now by the teams alternatively. A jump ball has been removed.
Yes, Mayor.
I remember we started playing opposite the ICI on grass courts, if you all remember. And then gradually, as the game changed at the national level, where we had to play on hard courts and wooden courts and all that, we went on to cement courts. Our tournaments were held on cement courts, and gradually we gave up. Actually, we had to give up that ICI, opposite ICI, because the underground took up that spot for the train that they were building. And it was great fun playing on grass courts. You slipped and literally, if it was raining, it was quite difficult. But we had to move from grass to hard courts and all, majorly because of the tournaments that were the senior, the basketball, the national level tournaments were being played on harder courts.
Yeah, well, I don't know if you saw this little...
Yeah, somebody's knocking you.
Yeah, somebody's hammering me. That's the production team who's done a ghusbet in my house. And she's got a boxing glove and she keeps whacking me if I'm overshooting time.
Oh, okay.
What I want to do now, ladies, is before I get beaten up further, let me move to your... let's talk a little bit. Prochi, you want to talk about the how we serve different state associations through the years and where we are on that now?
I think Rhoda should talk about that. She's headed the Women's Basketball Association in Calcutta.
Okay. Hi, Rhoda. Yeah.
Hi. Yeah. I was very fortunate to be the president for 5 years from 2001 to 2005. But before that, Zareen and I were constantly on that committee as vice presidents, and mainly as I was treasurer and she was a secretary, and we did that for many, many years. And Rochi is now on the men's association. And what is your, I think, vice president, no, Rochi?
Yeah.
Vice president.
That's right.
For 15 years, she's been as vice president on this association, men's association. Okay. And Beroz and Nawaz, they also served on the association for many years, as was Anni and Dina. I can't think of anybody else who served, but we all were there. Who? Aban, you served? Were you there, Aban?
Okay.
Me.
Yeah.
Meher was.
What I'd like to do who? Now.
Meher.
Beru was there.
Okay, what I would like to do now is get to a very important part of what I thought was your contribution in basketball, which is all of you played for the state at some point or another, or went for trials or whatever. So take it away, girls, and tell us, who all played for the state, how many years, what were your achievements there, what were the conditions like, what were the challenges you faced. So let's spend some time on that. Yes, Mayor.
Okay, so let me start this ball rolling. I played for the senior Bengal team 12 times at 8 nationals and 2 pre-Asians and 2 women's sports festival tournaments, out of which we won 1 national and we won 1 pre-Asian. And I was in one coaching camp, I think, ABS, as far as I remember. And so this was from, and out of the 8 nationals that I played, I was captain on 3 occasions and manager a couple of times. Nothing really, nothing much changed, except later on, like all these rules kept changing. So we had to just keep up with that. But the fiberglass boards, the hard courts, the rubber balls, it was a challenge, but it was great fun also. And it was a great sense of pride for me to represent CPC at that level for so many years. It was roughly from about 74 to 92. So it was a lot.
Beros, do you want to? Beros, Prochi, Rhoda, Aban, Nawaz, who do you want to
add? Let the older one start.
Yes, Beros.
Yeah, Nawaz, Shireen, and myself went for a lot of basketball nationals all together. And Shireen and myself went for the hockey. And in the basketball, for many times for the basketball, Nawaz was our manager also. But all she did in the train journeys was sleep. But she was a good manager.
Why? Because yes. She was asleep. Couldn't have.
Yes. So we could do whatever we wanted without her interference.
Hey, great. Yes, Aban, you had your hand up.
Yeah, I wanted to say that most of us here, I mean, all the way from Biroz and Shireen and Zareen and all of them have played for the state. At that time, many of us used to, and the team would comprise mainly of us Parsis or Anglo-Indians, which is very different from what it is now. So when we went for these trips, it was, you know, a very different feeling because we were mainly friends all traveling together. Okay. I've been fortunate enough to be there for 2 national coaching camps, one in Bangalore and one in Patiala. In Patiala, along with Meher, who was there for the senior team, whereas I was there for the junior team. And I've captained the junior team on 3 occasions, the senior state team on 2 occasions. And I'd like to just add that after our lot, Khurshid, Tenaz, Roxy and myself played, I think it was then perhaps just Farida who really played at national level. And then after that, there was a slightly bigger gap. And with the senior team, I think it's only been Kaizin, my daughter, so far, though a few other girls have played at the junior level.
Okay, nice. Lovely. I'm going to, you know, you mentioned Shireen and Zareen, so I'd like to actually move this along to the 2 people who were very much an integral part of your journey in basketball through more than 1 decade. So if you could, each one of you, whoever was going to speak for Shireen, I can't remember, and then for Zareen. So Beros, you can start, please.
Yeah, a sports person for excellence. That was Shireen Contractor. She played every possible game there was, and she excelled in all. I repeat, all of them. She was a great athlete and won many challenge cups over the years in the club. Not many of you would know that she could spin a top, fly kites, play marbles, and play gilli danda with the boys with equal ease. She was a great asset to any team and was possibly the only Parsi and perhaps also the only lady to have represented India in basketball, hockey, and cricket. It was a tremendous achievement for which she received many accolades and a lot of recognition, which she very truly deserved. Before her migration to Australia, she had also started coaching our children in basketball and gave them a lot of encouragement. She was not only my neighbor, but a very good friend. And I have wonderful treasure trove of memories of her childhood and playing days.
Right. Shireen was truly remarkable. Actually, I'm willing to put my neck on the line here. I think she's the only Indian, male or female, who's represented
possibly
in 3 sports, hockey, football, and I mean hockey, basketball, and cricket.
Possibly. I think so, but not too sure also. Yeah. But most probably, yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Beros, for that remembrance. Really appreciate it. Can I now move on to Zareen? Who's going to talk about Zareen? Rhoda and Kamal. Okay.
Can I say something about Shireen?
Yeah, okay.
She's in the Limca Book of Records. She had made it into the Limca Book of Records, if I remember clearly.
Yes, yes.
Uh-huh.
No?
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah. Should have mentioned that. I should have done some more homework.
Kamal, you go first. I'll say it afterwards. After Kamal, I'll talk for Zareen.
Go, Kamal.
All right. Zareen played basketball, hockey, and she also played table tennis and tennis very well. She was the club champ in tennis for a couple of years, and she was a very selfless player. She put everybody else ahead of her, and so that put me ahead of her, and she would wake me up in the morning, and I didn't like getting up early, and I remember her literally sometimes just pulling me out of the bed, and she was a great human being and a wonderful sister, and very, very loving memories of my sister Zareen, and she also was
I think we've lost Kamal's audio. So, Rhoda, can you pick it up, please?
Just my thoughts about my sister Zareen.
Thank you, Kamal. Rhoda, can you pick up your thoughts on Zareen?
Hi. Zareen was a hockey player par excellence and represented Bengal many a time. Still remember her flying down the flanks with the ball and centering it perfectly. Her sporting spirit was great. Even after some of her contemporaries retired from playing basketball, she still persevered with the younger generation during practices. Never mind that she didn't get a game and had to sit on the sidelines. The day after my wedding, it was Zareen who convinced me to come and play a hockey game. Such was her love and devotion to the team.
Thank you, Rhoda. Thank you very much. And yes, Prochi?
She's commenting about Zareen's love and devotion for the team, but she is the one who went for the match on her wedding day. Rhoda.
Who went for the match?
Who went for the match after the day after you got married? You went for the match, Not many would have
come. But she came and forced me to go. She came in the morning to my house and said, please come in the evening to play hockey. So I said, yeah, okay, I'm coming.
It shows your dedication.
No, it was hers. Coming and dragging me out of the house.
Yezdi, Shirin and myself also went for the inter-university basketball, and we reached the finals of the inter-university, which we played in Bangalore in 1970. But unfortunately, we lost. We traveled for 3 days by third class, three-level train. And then within 2 hours, we had to play. So none of us could walk also.
I used all to do those train journeys like from boarding school to Calcutta. From Pune to Calcutta, they were hell. But I recognize one pattern that everybody who's got a little sister ends up waking them up because they sleep too late. That's my learning from this session. Yeah. Yes, Rhoda.
Nawaz hasn't opened her account as yet. Why? Why is she so quiet? Ask her.
She's very quiet. I can tell you she's awake. I can see her on the screen.
She's awake right now. I'll tell you something about Zareen. She was our ramp queen. Whenever we went to any of our matches, when we went to Sri Lanka, she was our manager, and she kept getting wolf whistles whenever we entered the courts because she was all dressed all walking in style. And even during the Aryans, at night we had a fashion show. And in between, our beddings were right down on the floor. So in between was the ramp, and there was Zareen right first walking the ramp right down.
That's lovely memories. We are now into the time with the memories, we flow into anecdotes. And I would like to show you two clips recorded by Tenaz. And Mehr, I'll come back to you. I'd like to show you two clips recorded by Tenaz from Chennai. She couldn't be on the show with us this evening, but she's sent a couple of recorded clips. So I'll ask Ratan to play them one by one now.
Hi, a few words about Ani Aunty. She really was all in all for our age group. Basketball, hockey coaching, athletics training with jumps and throws. Then we had crafts class and sewing class at her house. And of course, bulbuls. Not to forget all the motherly affection she showered us with. We had much to be grateful for and many happy memories. And Jalu uncle also played his bit. Somebody once asked him at Parsi Club with much concern, are you having some health issues? Because he seemed to be losing hair. There were some strange bald patches on his legs. Oh no, he said. That's where Arnie tests her wax. The strangest memory I have connected with Arnie Aunty is at the Junior Basketball Nationals. There were three of us Parsi girls and Arnie Aunty was the West Bengal team manager. So the tournament had reached a critical stage and we were having prayer sessions. So the three Parsi girls, Aban, Roxy and myself, were seated and surrounded by Hindus and Christians. And we were saying our Zoroastrian prayers, supervised by Arnie Aunty, and trying to get God on our side. And then, of course, the Hindus and Christians said their prayers as well. And sad to say that this last-ditch recourse to God didn't really work out. We were booted.
Well, that was...
Ruchi and I used to travel to and...
And now we are almost nearing the end of our session, but Aban, I've got to ask you this question. Are you continuing the family tradition of testing wax on Al's calves?
Not at all. After he lost all the hair on his head, we are not taking a chance with the legs.
Good one, good one. Ladies, we are at the end now. I've got Mehr, the last person to talk on the show, on this session. Mehr, go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to talk about a very, very cherished period of my life with the CPC basketball team. After years and years of playing for them and seeing players leaving, not out of any other reason, but because they had to, we used to continue playing without any issue. In 1980, somehow everything just fell into place that year. And for the first time in the history of the club, we won the women's tournament, beating Rangers, beating Safis, beating Loretto. Loretto had two teams that year. So beating the second team as well as the first team. And why it was so so special is because after so many years, everything just fell into place for me personally as well, because having played and played and played for the club without much joy, that year also, everybody had a very strong team. Safis had Jennifer, they had Effie, and Jenny had just come back from the Asian Basketball Championships, where she was the captain of the Indian team. So everyone was fit and fine and ready to go. Same with Loretto. They had everybody. Aban and Khurshid were playing for Loretto that year. And they had Sarita, they had Shireen Mukherjee, they had Annie, they had Ellie. Everybody was there. So the victory was very, very sweet for us. And all of us played a role. For years, you know, we used to play with not more than 7 people in the team, because either everybody was going off and having their babies and leaving me to bell the cat, because I was not. So I was a constant one throughout this whole procedure. So, and it was nice that year because Shireen also came to play for us that one year. And it was a very memorable, that last match against Loretto was really memorable. And as soon as the match ended, everybody just ran onto the pitch. And who was leading that pack? Jimbo. And I saw him come straight for me and I was so scared that he would run me over. I just froze. But it was such a memorable evening. I cannot even begin to describe it. And yeah, That was the first and only year we have ever won the senior division league.
Okay, ladies, you know, when I started putting the show together, somebody told me that I am totally mad. Because you have to be insane to get 31 Parsis from Parsi Club coming on a show talking about their experiences. You'll be here till breakfast time. So, ladies, I'm sorry, love you, but have to leave you. And thank you so much for coming on the show and sharing some of your memories. I know these are not all the memories you have, but we would, you know, yes, Prochi? You need to unmute there. Yes.
I want to recall a very favorite memory when we used to go for practice in the morning, especially Saturday, Sunday, or a holiday. We would have to take 2 eggs, 4 slices of bread, and 4 annas for our breakfast. And while we were practicing outside, someone inside the club would be making the breakfast, and we'd come back for a feast together with dal puris brought by Behram Jilla. And then, of course, Bagu dropped all the ladies home.
Yes, well, Baduri was a heavy service. I always thought he should have got a van. He could have put more girls in, also carried some of the boys with him. Okay, ladies, thank you once again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And,
thank you.
In on a Sunday morning. Have a lovely Sunday back in the US. Stay well, stay safe, particularly in New York. And say hi to everyone in Toronto, including Lucy and Babsy. I was going to get them on and others onto a different segment of the show, but we'll do that sometime in the next couple of weeks. So, ladies, thank you once again. I'm going to try and figure out a way to get her back on the show again. But for today, it's good night. And thank you very much.
Bye.
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 Bye. Bye. Bye.
So, Ratan, we could, whilst we are waiting for, is Dr. Antlesaria in?
It seems like he thought it was 7:50. He said he can join in 10 minutes. So, maybe let's play some music and then we can get him on.
Right. I'll tell you what, we can get, there are two, yes, I would like to get the second musical bandbox number in, which is Nikaya singing I Can Boogie. She's our second diva on the Drama Kids. Everyone, we are waiting for Dr. Darai Sankrasarya to join us. I believe he's arriving shortly on Zoom. We're very glad to have him back. Ratan, any update on his timing?
I think in the next 5 to 10 minutes.
Okay. So what I suggest we do is let us bring in the men's golden senior group. And then when Daraz comes in, they can, just hide and wait till Daraz finishes his conversation with me and the viewers. So this is bringing in hi, Jal. Hi.
Hi. Hi there.
Hi, Badur.
I can't see Badur.
Hi, Badur. I can see him very well. He's got a very current blue t-shirt.
Me, Jal.
Partiality here because your son is the vice president of sports.
This is Jal here.
Everybody needs to get a blue Jal. Where is the other postie?
Having lots of internet problems. We old fogies are not so tech savvy. You'll have to bear with us.
That I agree.
He's trying to get in touch. Talking to him.
Oh, okay.
Rishi should be with us. Ruchi Jiji Boy should be with us.
Right. So, is Ruchi coming in?
Rashid is supposed to come in.
I'm just calling.
Jal, can you hear us, Jal?
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
And see me also properly?
See you very well. Thank you.
But was it uncanny that we all got blue shirts on?
Well, I had actually requested blue because...
I saw that.
The blue and, hey,
hi, Rusi.
How are you? James.
Hi.
Hi. Hi, Rusi.
Hi, Badur. Hi.
I like your blue shirt.
I like his beard.
Yeah. Lockdown chain, I think I've been at the gelatin blade up there.
Hey, wow.
Hi, Jinx.
Hi, Jinx. How are you?
How are you doing, Vita?
Lousy.
Okay, come on. You got to make the best of what we got.
Once you never stay at home, now you want to stay at home.
Yeah, what's to be done?
Yeah,
All India.
So, here we are.
Who's me?
Jal Postwala.
Ready? Come.
I just buzzed him in through the waiting room, so he should be with us.
Yezdi.
Yes, Jal.
You guys are so savvy and great at this connectivity and all that. And as Badur correctly says, we oldies are trying to get some sort of semblance of being savvy.
Guys,
but you guys are...
You're never too old to learn. I'm not a spring chicken. I'm 71.
You guys are miles ahead. Miles ahead.
Badur is pretty savvy with these things.
Yeah, Badur is very savvy. He sends me all kinds of... He sends me files I can't open and then No format.
No, right. Actually, hats off to him, yeah.
Jalu. Hi, Jalu. So,
has he come in?
But as we're waiting for, we can start.
Yeah.
Okay, we can start, and then when Daraz Santasaya comes in, we'll stop for him. Or we'll go through with your session and then stop. So I wanted to actually start this session. First of all, guys, thank you for being here. You all go back. You'll really go back 60, 65 years, and I was hoping that Cyrus Ayton would be on the show, but he couldn't make it, and neither could Nosher Adesha. But I think we've got people covering for them, and they've shared their comments with us, which will be relayed to the audience. So, let me set this in context. Yeah. When I was researching this, the first year I came across was 1954-55. When Jal, you were in the hockey team.
That's right.
And remember, for viewers, you should know that 1954 was 8 years after independence. It was 9 years after the end of the Second World War. And between 1943 and 1945, the end of the World War, Calcutta was bombed incessantly by the Japanese. But you know what happened in those years? Sports on the Maidan didn't stop. The Calcutta Parsi Club was located not in its present location, but more near Esplanade or Oxford Monument. A sport in the Maidan didn't stop. That's what I hear. So,
this is better.
Let me actually now start with asking Bahadur, take us briefly through the history of sporting activities of the club till the period that the three of you here and four of you here and others started playing for the club around the 50s. So just take us through that, Bahadur.
Thank you, Yezdi. Obviously, we'll be talking only for the men's side. You already finished talking to the ladies. So we'll be talking of sport as the men played it. And again, we have a restriction. We stop in the mid-60s or late-60s because you've got another team coming on to talk about the later period. Am I right, Yezdi?
Right, absolutely.
So then my comments will be restricted to that period of time and to the men only. Okay?
Yeah.
So, it's unbelievable, but the first game that was played in the club was not cricket, but football. That was the first game played, and we were in the Power League and some other Calcutta Football League in the early years. Records show that it was by 1929, that is about 20 years later, we were playing football, hockey, cricket, and tennis in the club. It's quite a good achievement. In 4 years, in 20 years' time, we were having 4 activities regularly being played. The familiar name in the cricket team of 1932 is that of Jimmy Madden, Cyrus's dad. It happened to be a year when the Karachi Parsi cricket team visited Calcutta in those days, to play friendly matches with the Calcutta Parsi club team. Can you believe it? The Karachi team playing cricket with the Calcutta Parsis. In 1933, the hockey team got promoted from the 4th division to the 3rd division, and they ended runners-up in the Parsi Cyclist Cup. They started playing first in 1930s, and we were runners-up in 1937 in the Parsi Cyclist Cup at Bombay Hockey. The first fixture versus Jamshedpur, Calcutta Parsis versus Jamshedpur Parsis in cricket, commenced in 1938. And between 1933 and 1932 and 1945 was the golden period of hockey, because we got promoted from the 4th division to the 3rd division to the 2nd division and then eventually to the 1st division. Quite a record. And there were 2 players who played in the 4th division in 1932 as well as in the 1st division in 1945. That is Fali Kanga and Jimmy Madden. Yezdi, I've been asked to say Darius is ready. So if whenever you want to interrupt, you can interrupt and get on to Darius. Okay?
Let's finish this bit. Okay. And
all right, fine. Up to you. You stop me whenever you wish, right? Fali Kanga, for those who don't know, was Bachi Karkaria's kaka. A great distinction by the hockey team in that period was the winning of the Lakshmi Bilas Cup. In Bengal, in Calcutta, Baton Cup is the prime cup, but the second most important cup is Lakshmi Bilas, and that's played by first division teams, and we beat East Bengal in the finals by 3-0. I do remember going to the CFC ground and seeing that match when I was 8 or 9 years old. In football, how many of us can recall that we used to, I'm saying, how many of us can recall that we played with Tommies in our team?
Yeah, okay. Hold it there. I'll come back on the Tommies later. Bahadur, I beg your indulgence. We've got Darai Sankrasarya just come into the waiting room and we will buzz him in shortly.
Hi.
Hi, Darai. How are you?
All good. What's up?
Thank you for coming on the show.
Will you? Can I? Can you hang on for a minute?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, minute. I'm here. Tell me.
Yeah. Well, thank you. I hope you've got your evening libation. Because it's
coffee with you. This time I thought I'd be diplomatic.
Well, let's see. I reversed the tables on you. Last time you gave me instructions. Now I'm following doctor's orders.
Well, I will leave you to guess what's in here.
I don't. Yeah. Probably a 18-year-old. Malt I'm talking about.
It is an 18-year-old malt. Anyway, cheers, Yezdi. Good to be here.
Cameras, Daras.
Tell me.
Okay, Daras, just your thoughts on what lies ahead. We are now, even if we crawl out of this lockdown in the next month, 2 months, 3 months, things are not going to go back to normal. The virus is not going away. Vaccines are at least a year away, if not more. We are in a vulnerable environment. And your thoughts on where this could end medically, and what should we as a community in Calcutta be doing to help ourselves stay away from the consequences of being exposed?
I think let's take the last question first as a community in Calcutta, because I think that's probably what's pertinent to most people, right? And unfortunately, we have a very aged community, Yezdi, and it's the aged who are absolutely maximum at risk here from this particular virus. So as opposed to the rest of our country, where the average age of our country is 28 years old. I mean, that's amazing, isn't it? That the average age in India is 28. So we've got this massive demographic dividend, which could work in some ways for us to try and overcome the virus as a nation. But as a community, it's another matter altogether, because I think one has got to, whatever strategy we employ to try and get the better of this virus, or to get the better of the pandemic, it will be protecting the elderly is going to be the first step. So that really means, in many relative ways, isolating yourself. If you're elderly, if you're above the age of 65 with comorbidities, and if you're above the age of 70, whether you have comorbidities or not, you need to be incredibly careful, which means physically distancing yourself and socially distancing yourself from people, and being incredibly careful about all the measures that you take in daily living, in daily life, whether it be definitely not shaking hands with anybody, saying namaste, not getting too close to people, being incredibly careful about groceries, about when you touch your face after handling anything else. It's going to be the same social and physical distancing going forward for the majority of our community, I'm afraid.
Right. Is it possible for at least the older members of the community, the more vulnerable ones, to get themselves tested at any point in time as a preventive measure?
Unfortunately, Yezdi, our government right now has not allowed testing for outpatients on a random basis. So, for example, when we have a situation right now, if I'm going to operate on somebody, I would have to admit them to hospital 24 hours beforehand in order that they can have a COVID-19 swab test done, and then subsequently operate on them after 24 hours when the report comes in as negative. And if it comes positive, then we still operate on them if they require surgery, but with all the appropriate protective equipment. And I can tell you, it's not comfortable for any doctor working in all that protective equipment, especially surgeons, when you're in the operating theater and working long hours. It just doesn't jibe together. So we've got to get that test done. But as a community, you can't get the test done as an outpatient, which is a crying shame, if you ask me. I mean, we need to ramp up testing a huge number. In our country, Yezdi, we're testing 700 people out of every million, as opposed to 21,000 people out of every million in the United States. 700 as opposed to 21,000. So that's a huge number. You need to ramp up testing amazingly in order to get people back on the road and to get the economy moving and to get your life back to normal. So the problem with testing is they have limited the amount that they're going to pay for a test. So paying, even though 4,500 may sound quite a lot for a test, it actually doesn't encourage people to produce these test kits in great numbers because there's no value in it. If you're going to invest a huge amount of money in a testing kit or a testing facility, and then find that a year and a half from now it's not required anymore, you wouldn't do it. So you have to entice people to be able to produce these tests, these huge numbers of tests, and we're so far behind in India, it's unbelievable. So it's not, I mean, testing is the way forward. Every study in the world seems to say that testing. So you need to test people and then you need to treat people.
Okay, I get that. There's a question that's come in from Roxy Balsara in Bangalore. And asking, once the airlines are open or, you know, air travel is permitted, do you recommend travel or should we just hold on till we are all vaccinated?
Oh boy, I tell you, do you remember what travel was like before 9/11? You don't really. This is a watershed line, isn't it? I mean, travel is going to change completely. I think nobody right now fancies being in a metal tube with another 150 or 200 people for whatever it be, 2 hours or 16 hours. So I think right now, from what I hear, airlines are going to open. My sister-in-law actually works for Etihad in the US. And so I talk to her regularly about this. And she was telling me that from July 1, they're going to start their flights, but they're talking about a huge amount of modification in aircraft. As you've probably heard already, the middle seat empty, every alternate row with passengers. In fact, some airlines are even considering reconfiguring the aircraft so that the middle seat is actually facing the other direction, so that your face is not right next to the guy next to you, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
In order to try and get more people on board and more people on the aircraft. So I think if airlines put in physical distancing rules and allowances, then yes, it's probably safe to travel with a mask on. But ticket prices are going to be astronomically high, I'm afraid. And if you really have to travel, you will pay for it, I guess, and go. But if not, no.
I get it.
I think you can travel. And I think if you're thinking about recreational travel, I would certainly suggest recreational travel right now is not on the cards. I don't think it's worth taking the risk at this moment in time. And it's not terribly comfortable to be on an aircraft with an N95 mask on for 2.5 hours or even more.
Good point. Talking about masks, going forward, I mean, you know, today everyone's using these masks, whatever you could pick up at the last minute before the lockdown when things were not really available after that. Do you believe that having an N95 mask is necessary going forward? Because
I think a mask is terribly important. A mask, whatever mask, is terribly important if you're with people. If you're going to be in an environment where there are going to be a bunch of people around you, whether you be in a store or if you go to a mall or even an aircraft, coming to an N95 mask, I think an N95 mask is probably more important for, if you really want to be safe, that's the way to go, but it's incredibly uncomfortable. But certainly for healthcare professionals, it's a must. It's a must. But if you had to go on an aircraft, the problem is that you don't know whether the person next to you is negative or is positive or negative, right? Because there are such a vast number of asymptomatic patients around. And as a consequence, if he is negative, if he's positive and you have just an ordinary surgical mask around you, lo and behold, he coughs or sneezes, you have a problem.
Yeah.
But be that as it may, I think a mask is something we should all wear when we are anticipating being amongst other people. But if you're out walking on the street and there's nobody else around you, you don't need a mask. It's silly. You don't need one. This is not floating around in the air. It's not. And that needs to be hammered into people.
I get it.
You know, but certainly if you go to a store, whether they're, you know, a small corner store or any standalone store, you're doing your groceries or you're shopping, and if you've got four or five other people in the store with you, I think a mask is a must. You can't always guarantee you're going to be 2 meters apart from somebody.
Right. What about face shields? If you have no choice and have to travel, is a face shield something that one should look at or not? Or is that just for medical professionals?
It's an added layer of protection. It's an added layer of protection over and above your mask. And God help you if you wear spectacles, because I can tell you face shields with spectacles are not terribly comfortable. I've experienced it in the operating theater last week. So your spectacles cloud up, they fog up, but a face shield is an added layer of protection for you. And I think it's probably more important for people who are dealing with or in very close proximity with others. If you had to travel and if you had somebody on the seat next to you, I would wear a mask and a face shield because they're so close to me and I don't know if they're positive or negative.
So my main takeaway on this is that if you have to travel, travel only if you must.
And absolutely. You have to
and wear a mask and a face shield because you don't know what's happening next to you.
I think you should keep a face shield in your hand baggage. If there's somebody sitting right next to you, put it on. But if there's somebody not, if the seat next to you is empty, you can do you're just good with a mask.
Rest, there's a more generic, general question from Urvaksh Mogrelia. He says, is there anything to show that Indians may react differently to the virus as compared to people from other countries?
The whole world is questioning that, Urvaksh, the whole world. And we really don't know. I mean, it seems amazing that we have such few cases in our country. We have so few deaths in the country compared to the other parts of the world. So we honestly don't know. And has it been, is it the temperature? They say, no, it's not the temperature. Is it the BCG that we've probably, most of us have had? We don't know. Is it the malaria? We don't know. Is it the chloroquine most of us have taken? We don't know. There is a huge amount that is not known about this virus right now. And everything I know, all these talk shows, all the TV channels are just full of it. But I'm fed up of watching them because the answer really is, I mean, I can put forward every single point to you, but at the end of it all, we don't know. We don't know. It hasn't been around long enough for us to know. So we really don't know. The issue is, I think, and as you've probably seen right now, the focus and the thrust in the rest of the world is to get the world open again, to get the countries open again. And I think that's what we have to concentrate on, and we have to have a strategy towards that. So what that strategy should be, there's so many different views, but I think a phased reopening as we're trying to do here is probably sensible. But having said that, we're reopening, you know, the green zones and the orange zones. But then you have to understand that the majority of our economy functions in the red zones. And that's the problem. You know, so they estimate that 100 million people are going to lose their jobs after this lockdown is over. 100 million. 23% of the Indian population is unemployed. Those are frightening numbers. Those are really frightening numbers. Sorry, Urvaksh, I'm digressing. To come back to your question about why we're not getting it, we honestly don't know. But these are all the theories, and you've probably read them and hearing about it every day on the news.
Right. I've stopped reading the stuff because there is way too much information that is more speculative than conclusive.
I honestly think, you know, all the energy right now has got to be into into a phased opening. And I think India is actually beautifully poised and beautifully placed to take on what, this is just my opinion, right? I'm just going to say it and put it out there and let the chips fall where they do. But I think we're a perfect country to try and eventually attain for herd immunity rather quickly.
Yeah. So there are a couple of other questions from Pesi Chawna and Raj Pantaki, and they're more or less the same as, how close are we to a vaccine, in your opinion? And is that the only solution to avoiding the virus?
Well, the not avoiding the virus, but I mean, right now, obviously avoiding the virus right now is physical and social distancing. As far as the vaccine is concerned, the world record for creating a vaccine, and I believe, is 5 years for the Ebola vaccine. That's really frightening, isn't it? But then Adarsh Poonawalla in the Serum Institute in Pune, as you all have all heard, has put a ton of money behind the Oxford group of the Jenner Institute, and they think they've got this wrapped up. They've even started human trials. The problem is, I think we'd be incredibly lucky to get a vaccine within a year. I certainly hope it happens, but if a vaccine comes up, that's the way to go. There are many, many different vaccines, types of vaccines. I don't think at any time in the history of the world, there has been so much collaboration among scientists and scientific groups to try and get this together. And I think certainly as far as the Serum Institute in Pune is concerned, it's been amazing, because he said he is happy. He's not going to patent this, which is amazing. He's happy to do it on a royalty basis because he thinks the knowledge should be shared. And I certainly hope he gets there quickly and produces this. He says he can produce up to 1.5 billion vaccines a year. But it's all very well producing the vaccines. We have to also catch up on the other side. You know, what vaccines are actually bottled and marketed in vials. You need glass. I was reading an article this morning where the world is way behind the supply of glass, which is required to put the vaccines in. So that has to be ramped up as well. That's something they need to think about. And they are working on many different types of vaccines. You know, the commonest one used to be where you take a virus and you weaken the virus and you inject it into somebody, like the oral polio vaccine is an attenuated vaccine. You have other types of vaccines where they take a part of a virus, just the protein, and use that as the vaccine. Then you have DNA and RNA vaccines. So all this is happening right now in the world as we speak. And I think a vaccine is the only way to eventually overcome this pandemic. It's got to be the only way.
Daras, there's an education-related question from two people. Yeah. Krishna Maibara and Aban Confectioner, who is the principal of a school. And the question from Aban is, any thoughts on how schools should start, and are children going to be susceptible, and how do schools manage this? And, you know, this is a whole different topic, but just from a pure health point of view, you know.
I think Yezdi, it's very difficult in India to think about. We will have to obviously reopen schools. It would be ideal if we could test everybody before, all the kids, before we reopen schools. Test the kids and the teachers and all the workers in the school. But that's not going to happen. But if we want to get this going, that would be the ideal scenario. But I don't think we've got an ideal scenario in this country. So next option would be make sure the teachers and all the workers have been tested if possible. And the kids, bearing in mind that when this affects a child, if it does, it very, very, very rarely is fatal. So, you know, you would have to think about getting schools going. But unfortunately, in India, we have crammed our classrooms so full of children that there's no hope of having any distance between them. I mean, kids are sitting literally one on top of each other. So it's going to be a big challenge, but a challenge which I think we're going to have to face if we want to get the country open again. And I think time over the next 1 month is going to tell us a little bit more as to what's happening, because without a doubt, we are ramping up testing in India. It is happening. I mean, Bengal, from testing 400 cases a day 10 days ago, is now doing 2,000 plus a day. So maybe it's gone more by today, by this evening. But so we are ramping it up. And I think we need a little more data over the course of the next 1 month. And as it is, we're lucky enough, Aban, that schools are going to be closed right now, right, for summer. So we have another 6 weeks on our hands before schools reopen. And I think that call can be taken closer to the time. although it will not be without risk. I think parents are going to have to understand that they're going to have to send their children to school with some degree of risk, as it is for anybody stepping out and when the country reopens.
So, Daraj, my question in relation to normal daily prevention, if you like. If you open schools, regardless of when you open them, the virus is still there. Right. And, there is a lot of talk and some examples of these sanitizing or detection tunnels being used, more like a sort of a plastic box, if you like, that you walk through and you're either sprayed or you get automatically, your temperature gets taken. Are these things, is this a practical solution or are we...
You can have your temperature taken, but the only way of actually probably sterilizing some, well, you see, you can clean the exterior of surfaces with UV light, right? So in fact, airlines are talking about putting UV light into the airline restrooms, into the toilets, so that when somebody goes in, uses the toilet, he comes out, the UV light comes on, sterilizes the whole interior of the toilet, and then the next person can go in. So they're talking about this. They're talking about, you know, having UV light to sterilize groceries in the back of your car and the interiors of your car. So, but I've not heard about a tunnel that a kid can walk through and get, I mean, you can have your temperature taken as soon as you walk into school, but there's nothing else that you can do beyond that, quite honestly, nothing. And I think the ideal scenario really, Yezdi, is for everybody to get vaccinated and go back to school. That is the ideal, right? But that's a whole minimum a year away.
Right.
So I don't envy anybody in power right now. I don't envy anybody sitting in the hot seat who has to take this decision about opening the country, opening up the economy, getting back to work, or reopening schools. It may just backfire in a big way.
I'm going to ask you a question because it's so lighthearted, but I don't know whether it's a serious question. But is it true that the consumption of alcohol makes us less immune to the virus?
Less immune?
Only be asked by a Parsi, by the way.
If it makes us less immune, I can promise you by now I'd be in trouble.
Yeah, that's my dose of daily immunization.
I really think the way forward here for this country is to actually take a concerted decision to reopen, to let the younger population gradually get back to work, even if it has to be in the red zones, with adequate education. I think we need to educate our public. Our people in power, politicians, need to go out there, talk to people, be very firm to them about social distancing, physical distancing, trying to impress upon them the importance of staying away from the elderly if they do go out to work. I appreciate that's very difficult in India because we have 2- and 3-tier homes where people often live with their parents and their grandparents. So it's very, very in cramped quarters. It can be very difficult. But we also have to understand that we do not have a population as a rule, in general. I mean, our entire population, we don't have such an aged population. Our community is a different ballgame altogether. But as a general rule in this country, it's the youngsters that are in preponderance. I mean, 28 years of age is our average age in this country. So we need to be able to take that risk to reopen, to get going in a phased way, in a careful way, with adequate education of the public. Because otherwise, what we're trying to do, this lockdown, this physical distancing, is going to kill many, many more people, Yezdi, than the disease. I can tell you that.
I truly believe that the cure is could prove to be worse than the curse.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So, Daraj, that brings us, I think, to a good point on which to. And thank you so very much for being with us, talking to us, and answering all these questions. And take care of yourself as well, because you're in the front line.
No! I told you. I said my only front line is surgery. It's other guys who are on the front line. More people like my daughter that are in the front line.
You're operating as inevitably you would be, and have to do on cases you can't prevent. You know, that's when protection is required. So, from all of us, stay well, stay safe.
Take care.
I'll be around, and I promise not to go out and play tennis because I'm over the age limit and all the other
issues. You're locked up at home, buddy. You'd better have a large supply of malt available. And I have Indira sitting over here. I think she said, be diplomatic and say coffee, not malt.
Not on this show. We're not diplomatic. Say hi to her. Say hi to mom as well.
Will do. Take care.
Thank you very much, Darius, and see you soon. Take care.
Yep. Bye.
Okay, we get all the. Let's get everybody in and. Okay, so. Bahadur, can we pick up from where we left off? We are now running seriously behind time, which was not totally unexpected. Plan B is to continue proceeding, and I will take the liberty of abbreviating discussion and comments as we go along, and for which I hope to be forgiven and not punished, but, you know.
So I was asking you, Yezdi, or telling you, Yezdi, that in the early 40s, we had a lot of Tommies playing for us in the football team.
Yeah. Okay. Hold it. I remember reading that the 1948 Olympic hockey team of India had 9 Singhs. Okay.
Yeah,
I never knew there were so many named Tommy in those days.
Oh, come on, Yezdi. These were the war years. We had a lot of British soldiers in Kolkata, and they were all called Tommies. And the surprising thing is not that they were Tommies and playing, but that we allowed Tommies to play in the Parsi club team of those years. That's it.
That is news to me. But would you like to come in and tell us more about the players of those days?
I can do it now.
Yeah, please do.
Yeah. Well, let us talk of some individuals in those years who excelled in different sporting activities of the club. While Nanabhai Langrana, who's the grandfather of Viraf, was elected as honorary life member of the Cricket Association of Bengal in 1960. In the same sport, Jimmy Madden, Keki Khambata being father of Bajo Sen, selected to play for Bengal in the Ranji Trophy. This was later shared by Meenu Patel, one of the fastest players to play for Bengal. Meenu, while playing for the club, had innumerable hat-tricks to his credit, and he had far more clean bowl decisions than any other bowler. He also had the distinction of taking all 10 wickets in one innings. Then we had Rusi Bhatena, who was called Bhai. He played for over 20 years. He was a slow left-arm bowler, leg spin, which I like to keeping wickets against because a lot of stumping chances were there. And he played for over 20 years and had several 7 wicket hauls to his credit. Then you had Jika, who is uncle of Vilu Batliwala. He was a great all-rounder as he excelled in swimming, football, hockey, and cricket. He reported to have played for football for Mohun Bagan Club also. Then, of course, you have Fali Anga, who had the unique distinction of playing both football and cricket for the club for 30 years without break. That should be a record in itself. Coming to Dolly Madden, who is uncle of Cyprus, he was the captain of Tanzania's cricket team, and he played for the Calcutta University as well. He was an all-rounder playing for the club's cricket team, a good hockey goalkeeper, and also the winner of the tennis singles tournament of the club. Then you had Mini Kola, who is stepbrother of John Kola, represented his school and college in athletics. He was also a batsman and he played hockey and football as well. Then you have Ratan Parak, who is father of Bum. He played hockey, football, and cricket for the club. And yes, he was also, he also played good tennis. It was in rowing that he made his presence felt, representing Lake Club in various All India and South Asia regattas, winning several events in the years between 1940 and 1947. Then you had Noshir Golwala. Now, he was a one-handed player. He only had one hand. And he was a one-handed wonder in hockey. He came from Karachi to assist the club. He was well known on the Calcutta Maidan.
Yezdi, can I get in with one excerpt about...
A very quick and astute halfback.
Yes, Jal.
Jal, just a minute. One little story about Noshir Golwala. As mentioned, he had a stump in stump of a hand having been severed just above the elbow. Rumor had it, and I think we saw it in some games, that whenever he was tackled by any player close by, he would use that stump to really give the other guy a dig in the ribs, and then he got away with the ball. But he was a wonderful player, with one hand dribbling his way through. Unbelievable.
So, Jal, can I take you to, the sport that was very popular in your days, that was tennis. And, you had tennis as one of those sports in the 50s and 60s. When we had four courts as compared with the three that we have now. Did you have any observations on those? Or you mentioned about Golwala, who was one-handed. I understand Dora Baidenwala was also one-handed. He had lost his forearm as a pilot in the Air Force.
Yeah, I'm come. Okay, so you want me to talk about tennis?
Yeah.
So apart from hockey, football and cricket, tennis was the next most important sport that we played. Yes, you're right. We had four courts, and the one closest to the basketball court was the best court and reserved for seniors. And then the other three courts for the and the one closest to the Mayor Road was for juniors. If we go back many, many years from the club records, it appears that in 1929, Ratan Dastoor and Sapal Tangri beat Soli Mehta and Jimmy Madden in the club's tennis finals. Ratan was an uncle of our own Dax. Sapal, the father of Sarosh. Soli was my brother-in-law. And Jimmy, Cyrus Madden's dad.
That is something. I mean, 91 years ago, and there are four elders, just one generation away from the present veterans.
And that's not all. Just a quick word here. We had two familiar faces on the tennis courts, Dorab Aidenwala. Again, one-handed. He lost his forearm as a pilot in the Air Force. He used to play tennis, and wonder of wonders, this guy would be able to tie his own shoelaces with one hand. Just unbelievable. And he played a good round of tennis, even serving with one hand. And another guy I would like to mention, very elegant, very, very well dressed out, Yezdi Tata, Alu's husband. Very elegant and good players. And of course, regular players, we had Jahangir Antia, father of Sam, also known as Chili, and Thriti. And of course, later on, Jambak Skapadia.
Thank you, Jal. Bahadur, I'm going to get you in here. You were once I mentioned about how classes were determined in sports in Calcutta and how the divisions then came in. So could you tell us a little bit about that?
This was in cricket, not in hockey and football. Like others, there were divisions and you got promoted and relegated based on merit. In cricket, which was the gentleman's game, it was a first-class team or a second-class team. And the first-class teams were decided, in my opinion, more on social considerations than on merit considerations. So there were teams like the CFC, the Rangers, Dalhousie, Customs, Port Commissioners, all of which had English players or Anglo-Indians. And of course, there were the Parsis. You did not have to win or lose. You could lose all the games and still retain the first-class position, provided you averaged 150 runs in the innings you played on 6, 8, or 10 occasions out of the 15 matches. Your best 6 or 8 were taken. You averaged 150, you stayed first class.
Oh, I know one of our most famous cricketing sons is on this show, Rusi Gigi Boy. And I'm sure if he starts talking about his memory, he'll be here till breakfast. But Rusi, 1969, we went down from the first division, and after that, we only had the pentangulars or quadrangulars or whatever we call them, pentangulars, I think. Those were where our cricketing achievements are now more, shall we say, consistent and even sustainable to some extent. So I know the next generation, Rusi, will have a lot more to talk on the pentangular. But, I would also like Badur to, talk about, give us the anecdote about Fali Kanga, who used to keep wickets for us. And when the club was playing matches, how did you organize lunch in those days?
Yezdi, you must remember that in the good old days, the cricket team paid for all the expenses that were to be incurred. Bats, balls, lunches, dinner, everything. But later on, gradually in the 50s, the club started paying for it. And Fali Kanga was in charge of lunch. My mother used to run this restaurant, the kitchen in Elphinstone. And he would go to her every week and bargain with her and try and get as much as possible out. He used to take me along for moral support. And I remember one particular day when he bargained for quite some time and then eventually settled on the menu of one mutton cutlet, one hard-boiled egg, chips, and a slice of bread. And that was for 1 rupee and 4 annas, or 1 rupee, 25 paise. And with great difficulty, mom agreed, he agreed, we were walking out. He stops halfway through, turns around and says, Pilamai, to my mother, Pilamai, there are paon par makhan bhi aap soke. So my mother shouted and yelled at him. And again, not to have the last word, he said, Kai ne Pilamai, there are makhan dur thi laga jo, but there are makhan, please laga jo. I can never forget that incident. Mommy came, when I went home, she was saying, Su karo tara fali sathe. It was very funny for me.
Let me now switch a little bit to football. Can I call Jalu Postwala up? Jalu, would you like to talk about, how we played football for several years in the lowest divisions in Calcutta since the inception?
Yeah, I will. Yeah. Now, the first of the Parsi club, after playing for several years in the lowest of the divisions in Calcutta, came full 46 years after the club started, when the team ended runners-up in the Chandi Charan Shield in 1954. After occupying low placements in the final league table of the Bengal Soccer League, we were happy to end the 1960s in second, and then in 1964, we reached finals of the Lady Harding Shield. Almost all our games we used to play were either on our home ground or on the neighboring grounds, which we always had a very large band to cheer us on. From the members motivating us this way, we have to mention the undying spirit of Fali Kanga, who took great pains to keep the football teams going for 30 years and more. He unfortunately passed away very prematurely in 1963. Yes, Yezdi.
Yeah. What I'm saying is that, yes, Jal.
I'm sorry, if you finished on this topic, think I'd be doing a disservice if I didn't mention a sport in which we produced All India champions and even champions of the Far East. Can I have a short time to mention about this? That sport is rowing. I had a small stint myself as an ordinary rower, but I think in rowing, our club members played a great part in the furtherance of this sport. We had Ratan Parakh, my brother-in-law, who was in the a champion in the late 40s. He took part in the regattas, which were known there as the ARAE, Amateur Rowing Association of the East. After him came Philly Medora, brother of Sam. Philly was also a good center forward and represented the university team in 46. Also a good rifle shot and an excellent athlete. In rowing, he also got All India fame in 51, winning the Macklin Sculls in the ARAE regatta. And on the way to the title, he defeated a Norwegian Olympian sculler in the semifinal. After that, we had Aspi Ayatin, also an excellent brother of Cyrus, excellent oarsman, a champion in his own right. However, all of these three have been overshadowed by only one guy, and that is our own Sam Medora. What Sam has done in rowing in India, I don't think will ever be excelled. In those days, with not having fiberglass boats, etc., Sam, before and after his accident, he had a terrible accident which left his one leg incapacitated. He won various events, the single, the Macklin Sculls, the doubles, pairs, and fours events in various regattas spanning over a large number of years. So I would say kudos to Sam for what he's done. The proudest moment for him was the invitation in 64 to participate in the world famous Henley Regatta, which you know is held annually in England, the highest honor an amateur oarsman could hope for.
Thank you, Jal. Look, guys, I know you all have done a lot of work and research and recollected your, recalled your memories on different sports. And unfortunately, we don't have that much time. I'd like to end with a few snippets of recollections that either of you may have. Bahadur, who was one of our most, who was our outstanding all-round sportsman in the club? Who would you think?
Oh, that's a difficult question. You're asking me to stick my neck out, but it's not that difficult. But I think undoubtedly Jalu Medora was our star sportsman of that period. There cannot be two opinions on that. There may be many more opinions on who would be second after him, but Jalu Medora was truly outstanding, cool, calm, collected, intelligent, just brilliant. And I was very, very fortunate to have learned my games under him.
Well, that's a very sweet thing to say. Jalu, as far as I know, held the club's tennis singles title for 10 years.
In a row.
In badminton. My recollection of Jalu on the tennis court was watching him play. But the first time I tried to play, he told me to buzz off because he didn't think my game was suited for the tennis courts. So I think I may have improved since then, but you know, that's my recollection. So I'm going to actually ask you to share any other snippets that you might have.
Let's ask Ruchi to share some of snippets. Ruchi, did you want it? Would you like to ask him, Yezdi?
Yeah. Ruchi, is there anything, any anecdotes you want to share about, sport in the club at any time, you know, one or two things that bring back memories and...
You'll all want to stay here till morning?
No.
if you want to stay, I can start.
No, I really don't want to stay till morning. I've got another 12 guys antsy out there waiting to get in. Okay.
Okay. No, I'm only joking. I'm just thinking, I'll just touch on one small point.
Sure.
Anecdotes, small. One is that Madhur has forgotten to mention Perk's restaurant. I think he has forgotten it or what it is. Intentionally forgotten. Because he had to shell out the most amount of money for that.
Oh, Perk's in Bombay used to have the best dansak, if you remember.
Oh, you see that. Chingri no patio, that was his dish.
Chingri no patio.
Let's get on with the show, Rusi.
Right.
One of the things.
Why don't you talk about the Malis, Rusi? Our favorite Malis of those days. Ghansham and Mohan and all of them.
No, no. They were truly very dedicated. In fact, when we went down, they literally were in tears. And it's not so much with Ghansham and all, because they're very old, but I was very young that time. But Ramesh, of all people, he was the latest amongst the Malis, and truly one of the most fantastic person here. The way he used to help out, get everything ready, and put everything for us, and get the thing. But other than that, I'll just relate, shortage of time, I'll just relate two small incidents. One is concerning Mr. Ayatin. Cyrus Ayatin was supposed to be here, I don't know. He's busy, he must be...
No, he couldn't make it, he couldn't connect.
He couldn't connect, okay. No, whatever it is, there was one incident with him and Motu. I think I must have told you about it. But Motu was fiddling at Sidi Midon, and Cyrus was the captain. And he shifted and told Motu, little this side, Motu, little went that side. Then little more this side, Motu shifted little more this side. Again, little more, come this side, little that side, little this side. Ultimately, what happened is that where Motu started off from, he came and ended back in the same place. So Motu was really, what the hell? I started from here and I've come back to the same place. And another one is, I don't know, in all the wisdom of our cricket committee, we selected the side, and Soli Khodaiji was one of our medium pace bowlers. So he bowled the first over. And after that, Cyrus was looking around the field, you know, that who bowled the second over, because they had not put a second medium pace bowler inside. Lucky for Calcutta Parsi Club and for Cyrus, saving face of the committee, cricket committee, there was one gentleman, Mr. Soli Mawalwala. He was at first snip. I was keeping wickets. And Soli told me, there are Cyrus ke umbi jara medium pace ball pekho. So I said, yo, I said, Cyrus, uncle says he can bowl medium pace. And it's such a relief on Cyrus's face also that he's got somebody to bowl the second over. And he gave it to Soli. And if any one person, at least this is my humble opinion, should have played for India, because he was based in Karachi, it is Soli Mawalwala. He was almost like another, what may call it, Gary Sobers. And he used to bowl left-hand medium pace, in-swing, out-swing. He used to bowl medium paces, leg spin, googly, what not. And he was a very good bat. So you can imagine how people get lost when they are not playing in the proper place at the proper time. They get lost.
Thank you, Rusi. Yes, Madhur, you need to unmute.
I have a message from Cyrus, who could not connect, as you know. So may I read his snippet? It will be very interesting for everybody. The last contribution to our...
Bhagur, would suggest, you know, we are not doing, I know that I've skipped so many aspects of what you guys were going to talk about, and I really don't want to do that. What is more, I don't want to shortchange the next generation that's coming up. So I've just, whilst you all were talking, I was discussing it with the production team, is that if you all permit, with apology, Let us close the session today and we come back next Sunday at the same time, and we can pick it up and have a lot, can have a whole hour to complete the men's sessions.
Fine.
The younger generation is going to be shortchanged, and it's 8:15 now. You'd be glad to know that we had 96 people, 96 devices connected at 6 o'clock this evening. And now we are down to 77. So obviously people are running off for dinner. And I would convey my apologies to everyone that, you know, we haven't kept time, but this was inevitable, because when you go down memory lane, you know, those are very, very long lanes. And maybe we were too ambitious to try and do the ladies and the men's on the same day. But I'd like to salvage what we have and not destroy our desire to recall and recollect. So with your permission, if I may close and come back next Sunday, is that acceptable to you all?
Yes, please. Fine, excellent.
Huh? Does it make sense? So if I have your approval and blessings, I'll apologize to all those people in the waiting room and those who were going to check into the waiting room that, guys, I'm really sorry, but it's 8:15 now. If we start now, we will be here till 10 o'clock. And I don't think we want to be talking to a virtual audience that doesn't exist.
No, it's absolutely all right. Absolutely all right.
Okay. Thank you very much, Jalu. And next week, I will open with my favorite Postwala observation. So get ready for that one.
Oh, you promised it to me.
Yeah, right, but I'm holding it for next week now. It's going to be my opening question. And the nation will need to know, I can assure you that.
Okay.
Okay, thank you very much. And Ratan, can you sort of come forward on the screen and help everyone off the stage? And have you able to communicate with everyone?